yet I hear a testimony of a lady who I met last October, I think it was, at the Reach Out Trust Conference in Redcar, and really impressed upon me so much. Just, you know, when we get saved, and we're just coming out of a, what you would probably class as a normal background, but some of us have come out of cult backgrounds. I used to be a Freemason, and I came out of Freemasonry. But this lady came out of spiritualism. And what she's going to tell you tonight really is just going to touch you in a way that you've probably never been touched inwardly before. So I'd like to introduce you to a very dear lady, Laura Maxwell, who's travelled down from Glasgow to come and share this with you tonight. So just bless her.
Thank you very much. Thank you, that was lovely worship. Thank you everyone for coming along tonight. Just would like to tell you my experience of spiritualism, and really to emphasise as well that my particular story is not at all unique. Really what I want to share has been experienced by countless others, whether in spiritualism, New Age, Wicca, shamanism, and even darker forms of the occult, because sharing my story on radio, internet, and satellite TV, I've had many, many emails and contact from people worldwide actually who went through very, very similar circumstances. Just a little bit of background. New Age, as most of you will know, is not actually new, but a mix of ancient, pagan and Eastern spiritual practices blended together. And it welcomes the dawn of the New Age, where in these last days more cultures will reject the more traditional faiths and become more open to things of the psychic phenomena. To explain a little bit for those who don't know, spiritualism involves platform addresses, where mediums give messages from spirits of dead relatives to the audience. It also involves psychic healing, rescue work, which is helping trapped souls move to higher realms. As a spiritualist myself, I used to believe in also in reincarnation, and that really the place called hell was just a lowest level in the afterlife. But you could escape from there and progress to higher planes through reincarnation, karma, etc. You maybe saw the film recently, Haunting in Connecticut. Some of that truly does happen. I myself, along with my mother, attended transfiguration sessions. During those, a misty ectoplasm comes from the trans medium's mouth and nose. Kind of looks like icicles hanging from them. It's a misty thing, and it solidifies into the dead spirit or relative. It can walk around and talk, still attached to the medium by a thin strip. It gives messages to the audience. But, you know, it can be quite a dangerous practice, as many mediums will know. If touched by a spectator, it can actually retract suddenly and re-enter the medium's body before the chance to reform back into ectoplasm. A very famous guy who was a medium, Victor Ernest, he himself was temporarily blinded by this, and he wrote of it in his book, I Talk with Spirits. We also knew, and this book also says that retracting in its solid form like that back into the medium can actually cause the medium to collapse, be crippled, or even die. So, you know, it's not a harmless exercise. Some practices used in spiritualism and New Age, like TM, yoga, hypnosis and Reiki have saw quite a massive growth in mainstream society. They were kind of shunned for decades actually, but they've become really more acceptable now in, for example, NHS, counselling, self-improvement, psychology, relaxation therapies, and even in some churches. New Age leaders like Benjamin Creme and Alice Bailey welcome this shift into mainstream culture. Folks, though, unwittingly pursue such practices, not knowing that they actually do contain spiritual exercises which can tap into occult powers. And it is often a progressive thing with the New Age, whereby one may start, for example, with yoga and then develop a hunger and delve deeper into more deeper parts of it. A lot of folks feel that all New Age activities are harmless. But, for example, even in yoga, even the trained yogis themselves do admit, actually, that the basics of the very first stage of yoga is to attain mystical union with the universal spirit. And yogis themselves warn that yoga, TM, and opening chakras can actually arouse dangerous supernatural forces. And that to arouse, in particular, the Kundalini serpent, which is the spine chakra, is very dangerous, and that is yogis themselves who say that. So, whether those who do even basic yoga for relaxation, whether they know or not, they have literally opened the doors to spiritual entities. So, why did I get into it myself? Basically, I was always interested in the supernatural since a child, but just before I was a teenager, my mother was walking the dogs in the local park, and she was approached by a local medium who really did see her potential to become a medium, and he invited her along to one of the spiritualist churches in Glasgow. And she wanted to be a medium because she was interested too, so she did go along, and I went with her. But to backtrack a little bit, even as a child, I was interested in psychic experiences, and I did have a few, for example, premonitions, dreams that came true. We had a family history of it as well. My mother's cousin was involved, and her uncle, he was a head medium in a spiritualist church. So, you know, it was something that my mum was interested in, and she was aiming to become a medium, and that was really one of her aspirations. So as a young teenager, I became more interested in it and developed quite a hunger for it, becoming increasingly fascinated by psychic readings, healings, ESP, rebirthing breathing, crystal healing, meditation. And my mother and I, along with our psychic friends, we would read books on astrology, telepathy, astral projection, and we tried alternative therapies too. We attended New Age centres, psychic fairs, that kind of thing. When I had my very first private reading, I was still at school, and I was told at that private reading by the medium that my dead sister and my dead gran were there in the room to talk to me. My gran died when I was very young, so I didn't even know what she looked like. When they described her, I had to ask my mum later on, is that what gran looked like? And she said yes. Also, I didn't even know, but my mother had actually lost a baby. So the medium told me that as well, that I had a baby sister now in the spirit world. So because I was never aware of that before and didn't know that, obviously I couldn't have influenced the medium, you know. In any way, many facts like these proved to us that mediums were very accurate, not charlatans, they were not using guesswork or trickery at all. In my late teens, along with my mother, I attended development circles where you were trained in clairvoyance, clairaudience, clairsentience, seeing, hearing and sensing spirits, for those that don't know what that means. Mum was really quite ahead of me, and she began to communicate with dead spirits, channeling messages from them. We learned plenty of other New Age practices too, and we read papers such as the Psychic News, books by White Eagle, Ascending Masters, and so on. Plenty of mediums that we knew, and also mediums that didn't know us at all, would visit the spiritualist churches and give messages, and often they would say that one day I myself would become a psychic artist, that I would draw portraits of dead relatives or dead spirit guides when they appeared at seances or private sittings. And they also encouraged me, they said I had a gift for photography. Well, I didn't do that in college. And they said to practice psychic Kirlian photography, which is really using infrared film to catch images of spirits and ectoplasm. At that stage, I didn't pursue it because I was pretty busy. I was a young teenager, I was at college, that kind of thing. But I did plan to pursue it later because I did want to become a medium when I was older. So my mother, she really went right into it deeper than me. She got to the point where she was involved in automatic writing, where spirits totally took over her hand. She would be in a trance, and they would write so-called sacred texts through her, using her as their vessel. So really we were very, very involved. It was our whole life, and every week we were involved. And this went on. My mother and father divorced, and really when that happened, it allowed my mother to go into it much further, because my dad wasn't really interested. So in my early 20s, or my late teens, we began to suffer some spiritual problems and psychological effects, such as feelings of evil foreboding, sleep paralysis, night terrors, which were heavy weights and presences pushing down our bodies, invisible hands choking us, strangling us. We actually had already heard from other spiritualist friends that we knew that this can be a common thing for people in spiritualism. We did hear about it quite often. We were involved in about 3 spiritualist churches, and we always were meeting new spiritualist friends at New Age fairs and that kind of thing. So we were aware that danger was there. We tended to ignore it, to be honest. We'd heard rumours around, as I say, the 3 spiritualist churches we attended, that some mediums' homes actually became haunted or possessed, and even that their long-term spirit guides would actually turn on them for no apparent reason, keeping them up at night. They would have poltergeist activity in their house. So we were beginning to get a bit confused and wonder, why is this happening? Can we stop it? And all we discovered really was that the head mediums certainly would try. They were very helpful, very kind people. But they were often quite limited and powerless in totally stopping such events. And some individuals, very sadly, were sectioned and admitted to psychiatric wards because these spiritualists or mediums had become a danger to themselves and others. As I say, simply because their spirit guides were now taking control of the medium against the medium's will, taking control of them, not when they wanted to get into trance, but when the spirits wanted to work through them. And some mediums were saying their spirit guides were even threatening to hurt people. So, as I say, we had heard of that, and we kind of turned a blind eye to it because it was so fascinating, the whole realm, and we loved it so much that we thought, maybe the odd negative thing can happen. We tried to not really think about it. But when similar things began to happen to us, obviously we had to think about it a bit more. We were subjected to poltergeist activity, such as hands chapping from inside wardrobes, doors slamming shut when there was no draft, electrical appliances coming on, even though not plugged into power. My mother was actually thrown around the house as well by spirits. And even outside, several times while we went shopping, we would be walking along the busy street, and all of a sudden my mother would be lifted and thrown in front of cars. Once she was actually thrown right on top of the bonnet of a car. Luckily it was at a crossing, it wasn't moving. Much to the shock of myself and witnesses. Again, as I said at the very beginning, this is not unique to me. It's not just that this happened to me and my mum. We've heard of it happening to other spiritualists and mediums. And indeed, since I became a Christian, I've read of books, plenty of books by other former mediums who went through this too. One guy, quite a famous medium called Ben Alexander, he writes of it in his book, Out from Darkness. We also heard rumours of some mediums who had progressed to Satanism, and again, we didn't want to think too much about that, but I remember sometimes we would look in our own spiritualist church and think, well, we'd hear sometimes Satanists can secretly infiltrate spiritualist churches and scout for new members, because they can obviously sense mediums who have potential to become Satanist disciples. Really, things were getting so bad, you know, in my mother's house with the poltergeist activity, and just we had friends who ended up psychiatric wards, spiritualist friends, and it seemed to be happening more and more. We're hearing far more about it. So we got to the boy we wanted out. Sometimes when people had these negative experiences, the mediums would be obviously very kind, and they would try and explain it in that it was a lower level spirit who had managed to get through, but that our spirit guides would protect us. The mediums even said that our spirit guides and relatives were genuine, and they weren't mischievous spirit guides at all. My mum and I had good spirit guides. The mediums, they couldn't explain why these spirit guides became obnoxious and violent towards us. You know, they even said it wasn't a case of like attracts like, as the mediums we knew in three different spiritualist churches had said Mum and I had good spirit guides, Mum and I had no negative energies or karma to attract them, we didn't have less evolved guides, and we hadn't signed up for this trouble in a prior life. So at this time, I'm thinking we're getting so bad, and lots of spiritualists and mediums we knew tried to cleanse our house unsuccessfully. Really what happened, friends who were new agers or mediums began to abandon us, just because they couldn't clear our house of these bad spirits. I can understand it, because I would imagine putting myself in their shoes, and I'm probably pretty embarrassed and not able to help, and also probably quite frightened. They were all very nice people. Must have been confusing for them, and I certainly forgave them and do still forgive them for deserting us. Every spiritualist, every psychic we met were kind, genuine, helpful folks with good motives. I want to emphasise that. They weren't evil or nasty, as some ill-informed folks assume. They just assume if you're in the occult you must be a nasty person, but I can assure you that's not true. I never met a medium I disliked. Let me emphasise that. I haven't got an axe to grind with any medium. It's simply the evil spirits that I dislike. As I say, my mother's spirit guides were now coming through her almost 24 hours a day against her will. Once they forced her into a trance when she was frying chips, and it led to a fire in the kitchen. She was in a trance, so she didn't know what was happening. Her spirit guides even told her to begin to murder people. Sounds a bit bizarre, and it certainly sounded bizarre to me, but she knew her spirit guides. She'd known her spirit guides for years. Why should she doubt when they say that person's evil? We need to take them out. Basically, my mother began to write threatening letters to certain people, and the police were involved, naturally. She even told me that a very trusted spirit guide that she'd known for years told her that she had to kill my dad. So really, as I say, we were at the stage now where we were trying to leave spiritualism. One night my mother was actually attacked all night long by her spirit guides, all night long, physically attacked. She saw a large eye on the wall, and she saw snakes on the bed. She saw things that a lot of folks probably wouldn't even believe, but I do believe her. She thought it was Satan, and she said it only disappeared when she shouted Jesus Christ repeatedly. Now, my mother hadn't called on Jesus Christ before. She wasn't interested in the Bible or Jesus. It was just spirit guides and spirits that she was interested in. Also, myself, you know, I was still living at my mum's, and I was going through this too. Not to the extent she was, but I'd always had my dead sister coming through to me for years. And at night, she would often come and actually stroke my hair. But now, when we were trying to leave spiritualism, I think this is the key point, when we were trying to leave it, she started to come and put her hands on my throat. She tried to choke me and strangle me. And I would be coughing, the bed would be moving. You know, typical kind of poltergeist activity. So my mother and I were desperate. We had no one to help us anymore. You know, the spiritualists had left. So we tried ourselves to deal with this. We tried to stop it by cleansing our auras, closing our chakras. We made lists of many gods. We called on many different spirit guides. We called for more evolved spirit guides to help. We made lists of Buddhist gods, Hindu gods, anything we could think of. But, you know, not one of those gods could actually help. And my mother's sleeping pattern was obviously out the window. She was stressed out, as you can imagine. This was going on for years. So she went to the doctor. And I think my mum and I just assumed a lot of people would believe us. But my mother didn't. The doctor couldn't accept such things as spirits, and basically just said my mother was a schizophrenic. So she was incarcerated in a psychiatric ward, and as I say, we had known of other mediums before this had happened too, so it was a shock, of course, but we had heard of it. And funnily enough, even as a spiritualist, we knew mediums who would say,